Nee, I'm going to the continuous delivery meter for now a year or 1.5 years and get and talk. And then half a year ago, I decided, that I switched companies. I've been working with another company for 13 years and then I was finished with that and I moved to the Belastingdienst. So I told that to, to Patrick, and then he said, oh, that's interesting. If you're going to do a continuous delivery over there and things like that, can you host us? And I said, only 10 days or something like that, working here at the Belastingdienst. I said, yeah, sure, why not? That should be a good idea. So half a year later, we are now here, and I'm allowed to give the talk. I had a very good idea at that moment what to talk about. Like, okay, this is the situation now, and so in half a year we should be over there. So I have a lot to talk about. Okay, half a year later, it's now we're a bit not as far as I was hoping, but still, I think I have some very interesting things to tell. First, of course, a little bit of an introduction of myself. I only work half a year now. I've mainly worked in the Oracle world. I did some presentations there also on Oracle Open World. And I think 13 years ago, my career started in continuous delivery when I had a project in New Caledonia, which is on the other, about 40,000 kilometers from here. They hired me because I wrote a few blogs about automation of your build process. At that moment, continuous delivery didn't exist as a term, but still we were starting. And since then, I haven't looked another way. Okay, a short disclaimer, because I only work half a year with the Belastingdienst. I talk a lot about what we are doing, but a lot of it is my own personal experiences or my personal views on things, and not necessarily reflect my manager's or the manager's manager or the manager's manager's manager point of views. So, but I hope that they will forgive me what I say here and that I'm allowed to continue here. On the one hand, everybody knows the Belastingdienst, but a few numbers are always interesting. Is that it concerns a lot of money. That doesn't mean that we can spend this all on our IT, because we have to spend it on the maatschappij. And the less we use for IT, the more we can use on the roads and things like that. So. It's, you see here different colors. This is blue, this is red, and there should also be a green. This is a green one, because they represent the colors of the different aspects of the Belastingdienst. We don't only collect money, we also spend money on toeslagen. Nee, toeslagen op, wel toeslagen. Ja, toeslagen on, I didn't practice this how it's in English. Subsidizing stuff, things, and a lot of things. And the other thing is the douane, the
customs,
which is also a very important part of what the Belastingdienst is doing. Okay, about IT, there's about 29,000 employees with the Belastingdienst. About 2,500 are IT, and of that there's about 250 Java developers. We have 90 Java teams and about 200 Java applications. There's a lot more to talk about all kinds of applications, but it gives a little bit of scale. It's not only, another interesting thing is it's a very political organization, which means that this is Prinsjesdag. This was in September, and there were some ideas that we had to implement. Yeah, what is it? 2019. So, of course, now we're happy that we didn't, that this one is not continuing, but still, that means that we sometimes have to take very sharp angles and act on very short notice. It's a big organization. This is all the aspects of the douane, the fiat, the customs, and the different types of tax things. And there is IT. The interesting thing is, when I first saw this picture half a year ago, is that it actually, IT is becoming much more and more, what is it? A first-class organization aspect of the of Belastingdienst. So it's here, it's one of the many, but it's at the same level. It's not supporting, no, it's one of the prime aspects. Okay, so we're in Apeldoorn, we're currently here, and this is another location we have in Apeldoorn, that's where the data center is. It's not exactly that development is here and the data center is there, and operations is there, because there's also a lot of the development there. But it's an interesting thing that's this distance. When we have a look at the Java environment, this is about the some key aspects of it. We work mainly with Eclipse and IntelliJ. We work mainly on Java Enterprise Application Standards. But there are some other interesting applications. There's even some COBOL still. We have .NET applications development, especially the apps development is doing that. We do some BPM, this is normalized systems, this is business rule stuff. So there's all interesting other kinds of applications, not only straightforward Java development. We do it on mainframe, and we do this already for since the 60s, which means that, so we do this already since the 60s, and when you compare us especially to other countries, we are quite successful in our IT way of working. On the other hand, we're still making headlines in the paper, so there's still a lot of room for improvement. Important aspect in it, I'm part of the Java Ontwikkelstraat team, JOS, as my colleague Bram is also, and there's about 8 other people in the team, and we will come later on what we are exactly doing, but that's you will see the name coming a few times during the presentation. Okay, enough on, if you have, by the way, if you have any questions, don't hesitate. Yeah.
I noticed you're using Splunk, but wait, first of all, thank you for still making it possible to do my Belastica on Linux. that's a very important feature to me. I see you're using Splunk. It's a third party. Is there a big policy around that, or?
Oh, there's lots of policies over here. And one of the things is that later on there will be some a little bit of slides on that. On the one hand, we can decide ourselves what we want to use. On the other hand, there is indeed a department that has to check and on what is it on licensing and stuff like that. And in addition, we are a governmental organization, which means that if we spend a certain amount, we come above a certain level, there must be a tender. Which means that indeed there's Splunk, so yeah, ELK, Elasticsearch, Kibana, yeah, maybe could have been there too, but I don't know exactly. But these are aspects that you have to take into account in here.
Wait, was Java a conscious choice? Is there still reasons to only have everything in Java?
We don't do everything in Java.
Okay, thank you. That's a good answer for that.
And we're still, evolving on the Java frameworks and things like that. But it was in the 90s, it was definitely a conscious choice, and in the 2000s and things like that. And definitely currently still, there's many good use cases for it. In addition, we are also working on JavaScript frameworks and things like that. As is the choice for example, BPM or less, the less code frameworks and things like that is also an aspect.
Okay,
Are we allowed to know which version you guys are on?
Yeah, it's Java version.
We're currently on Java 8 and Java 11 is now authorized to be used too. But that doesn't mean that our mainframe is running on there. We just had a big migration from Java 6 to Java 8 because it's mainly it's the final runtime that determines on what version we are running. I can as a developer decide, okay, let's run it on 11, but yeah, when operations doesn't support it, then okay. That was not what I'm. We can talk a lot more, but I want to have a look at our delivery process on how things were going, how things are currently going, and where we are going, and what aspects, what things we encountered, and things like that. This is a bit the maturity model that I'm using, continuous integration, continuous delivery, continuous deployment, and something which I call continuous integration plus, which will make sense when I will come to this information. So, in essence, we have a very simple delivery process. We did it four times a year. We have development. We create an artifact. We write a document. Then we give it to somebody at operations, both of these things, and they deploy it on the mainframe, either on which environment that is. These were smart guys, because they wrote for themselves a little bit of an automation tool. Auto-deploy, it is called. But that was only for themselves and not for us to use. But, yeah, unfortunately, things change. So, this is one thing, so there's the mainframe. In addition, we don't only have mainframes, we also have the IBM IPaaS environment, which is basically a more virtual machine-based environment with Linux servers. And there is some Microsoft and there is some AIX, although the latter is, I think, it's not completely switched off yet, but it's almost done. So this is the global picture. And since operations have their own base in the other part of Apeldoorn, there's a lot more to talk about, but that's they can do them much better. So that was the Stone Age. I'm not going to talk about the Stone Age. I'm going to talk about the basically when continuous integration started to get off, which is, I don't know exactly when, but in essence, it started here as in many organizations. We do some build automation, we have some manual releases and deployments and manual tests, but at least we have a little bit of automation. What happens? This is always driven by developers and by technology. Hey, there is Hudson. That was what we were using. And Hudson is a nice scheduler and that can schedule Maven tasks. And we are already, Maven is what we're using or could be using for a Java application. So hey, one and one is two. We have our ClearCase source control. So now, very nice, simple jobs. And at that moment, I don't know when, but at my other company, we experienced the same things. That was basically, this is what brought me back then to New Caledonia. So when you do it at the right moment, then people are wowing you. So the challenge then is getting skills, getting knowledge, getting familiar with everything, with the technology. It's most of the time unmanaged infrastructure, so you have to get it managed, and you have to get the operations team to get it managed. What? A source control system? How are we going to manage that? We don't know. I know a database, but and there are mainly local initiatives. Okay. I think that's enough, because it's interesting what we are now. So the next step is a bit further. We still do build automation, we do some scripted releases. We all know that in Jenkins and in Hudson, we know the release plugin that you can click on and it handles the whole release for you. And it puts your sources into Nexus, the artifact in Nexus. And From there we can do an automatic deployment to O. As you saw, there was still this guy at the mainframe. Since that is not a really standardized way of deployments and automatic deployments and things like that, that was for a long time as far as we could get. Deployed to the O environment, the development environment. And then we had to write the papers and provide it to the operations so they can manually install it, and then we can manually test them, or maybe have already some automated tested. Still driven by developers, driven by technology. Now, instead of only Hudson, there are some other environment build engines, but we're still using Jenkins. Hey, we moved from ClearCache to Git. That was a big improvement, although at that time there were lots of people probably not so happy with it, because if you're used to one tool, then another tool can be complicated. We started to use Jira, a bit complexer job chaining. I think I saw some nodding, so I saw some recognition of people that they experienced the same things. And at that moment, the challenges we experience is still, how does it all work? How can we, do we handle it? But also the adaptation, because it still costs a lot of effort, and there's a lot of product owners that say like, what is that worth it? So as a developer, as a technology, we still had to fight the business to explain them why this is a good idea. At the same time, what we saw is that instead of local initiatives, it starts growing. Other developers and experience like, hey, this is a good idea. They also want to do it. So you need a good environment. You need a good infrastructure. You need to do a bit of standardization and things like that. So, and in essence, this takes time. And a company, when you are with 3 teams, that takes time. And a company with 80 teams takes more time. More on that later. So that was a few years ago, still before I entered here. But that's so I can only tell by second hand, not by direct experience. Basically, we're coming at the point that we are now, more or less. That's what I call continuous integration plus. Things becoming more automated. Build automation, we do an automatic release, we do automatic deployments, and hey, we were already able to deploy to the T environment. And sometimes if you knew the right people, you can get it a little bit further. But to production is that's still a big challenge. And because the development is getting more and more automated, the testers are experiencing also more and more automation and thinking like, hey, that's a good idea. Yeah.
What's the difference between automated deployment and manual? Do you then mean we use Nolio or some deployment tool to deploy it to P, so you start a job?
In this case, no.
Or you actually are copying files to P and...
In this case, we have our, Jenkins environment to deploy it to to the development server. And then we hand it over to some operations guys, and they have their own way of deployment to the production. And so, it's not a Jenkins, but I'm not exactly sure what
they do. They do use auto-deployment.
Yeah.
Sorry, so the technology under the hood they use, but not the pipeline.
So it's not completely manual, but it's a different process. Yeah. It's not automatically.
Yeah.
And they started off by hand, by clicking on it. Yeah.
Now, actually, where we are here now is that, especially at the Belastingdienst, a lot of these things are driven by what we call the deployment automation. I'm a developer by nature, not an operations guy by. But at operations there is a team, the automation team, and they have the goal is to automate the processes. And to make sure that we as a developer can also use this automated process to do development. That started about the beginning of this year, the end of this year, which doesn't mean that they didn't do any automation, but that they brought it, started on the next level, that we are, and make it much more accessible to other teams. This was basically a big drive for us to be able to deploy to the T and the A environments and things like that, to standardize the way to deployments to the, yeah, where we needed to. We have a Jenkins 2 environment, and that's why I call it plus plus, because that's basically what the recent years where everywhere you see we use pipeline scripts instead of separate jobs, and the job does something. It is, what is it, pipeline as code. And that's basically the development that everybody now is applying, and every tool set or whatever, pipeline as code. So that's what's also, so this again, technology drives this, and the developers are driving this this feature. What are our challenges? Standardization. That's one of the big challenges. We have 80, 90, whatever, the Java teams. And one of the important things is that we don't want to create a delivery legacy. It is pipeline as code, which is code. And if you don't organize the stuff, much more on that later, and if you don't have a decent knowledge and skills process, you create legacy the moment you are programming. And that is one of the big challenges, especially in big organizations, on making sure that people are doing the right things. The other thing is scale, because it starts small, and then at a certain point, people, other teams want to use it more and more and more and more, and you have to support it and things like that. And the third is because you want to standardize and cover your knowledge and things like that, that in many organizations, and here in the Belastingdienst also, we have a central team, the Java, the JOS team, which is the, what is it, the central team to organize this. But at the same time, we want to be flexible, and we want to make sure that teams can deliver what they need to. So there's big challenges. So that's the general theory.
They said there were 80 teams in
something like that.
Are they doing this at the same pace or
no?
Okay.
No, it's all on different paces, and that's what I will count. There will be a little bit more on how we actually do this. So currently at the Belastingdienst, we have a delivery pipeline version 1. We delivered that beginning of this year. That's a big challenge. So this was a big mountain that we climbed. And we had our managed infrastructure containing Jenkins, Nexus, SonarQube, Atlassian stuff. We do this deployment automation by a tool that we call Dink, which is our own tool, our own deployment tool. This infrastructure is adopted by almost all the teams. There's a few of them that use their own Jenkins environment, but not much. So that's already a big achievement. Instead of teams thinking like, hey, I can do the same thing better, they opted for using our platform. So a little bit on Dink, because that's our custom deployment platform, and it's mainly focused on deployment to mainframe environments. What do we have on mainframe? WebSphere application server, DB2 databases, MQ, authorization stuff, BPM stuff, data, all kinds of stuff is on there. And it's all complicated, and this auto deploy tool that I told you before is a custom in-house scripts. So this was the next step for the teams. It is, on the one hand, a very powerful tool. There's a plugin architecture, and actually currently there's a lot of, there's multiple teams writing their own plugins for their deployments. So they have created a very good ecosystem of teams organizing the deployment to the runtime environment. Now the question is, why do you make your own tool instead of buying one? That's a good question. A few years ago, we are an IBM company. IBM had their own deployment tooling. Urban Code Deploy. That failed. So we don't use that anymore. Then there's another famous of a tool by Cibia called XL Deploy, which is already there for some years. But there are not many more tools, and that's maybe a bit like... So, when they started with Dink a few years ago, they did an evaluation, XL Deploy or not. And actually what they decided upon was that by creating their own tool, continuing building on the scripting and the automation they already had at their operations team, they expected to have a better support and a better momentum internally on having this on the acceptance of this tooling, instead of getting an extra tool and you have to all learn this tool. It is basically you can still do whatever you like, but we bundle it in a standard way. And the idea is that it provided with the Belastingdienst a much better ecosystem on the adoption of automation on the deployment aspects. Which doesn't mean that we will never, that we always will stick with this tool and that we will never move to something else. Because we also do regularly, and I'm not sure which if every department does the same thing, regularly check our tooling and check on, evaluate our tooling and see how we continue on it. So for now, this is what we have, this is what we use, and we have some Maven plugins and things like that to use it, and you can manually deploy. So it's an interesting tool. Let's have a look at our pipeline. And then you say, at our pipeline, at, yes. As our central JOS team, we created a pipeline. And why is that? Because there's a lot of teams out there that are not used to, that are actually done, now I'm, that actually don't know how their delivery process looks like. That sounds a bit weird, and that it might be a bit weird, but actually you saw the picture in the beginning. As a developer, I code, and then I create something, and you put it on production. And that was, actually, now in autonomous team organizations, we think that's a weird way to go, but I must say, as a consultant, I've seen many organizations that were, for a long time, have been organized like that. And it's true that we must change that, but that's not changed overnight. So how can we help our teams adopt automation? Is by doing things for them and provide them with a standard way of doing things. So we create a pipeline and you can use it without, or we have some documentation, some instructions, you do it this and this way, and then you're up and running. Great. So that was adopted by a lot of our Java teams. Now our delivery pipeline looks actually quite simple. We develop, we have we build, we create a release, then we have a certify step, which means after all the testing and things like that, there's somebody who has to say, yeah, this is okay, you can continue. We have to integrate, because there is a lot of integration. when you do your tax, what is it? Yearly tax aangifte, you already have there, for example, your bank accounts information over there. That's integration. It's only a little bit of the integration, but there's a lot of components talking to each other. So we have to test the combination. And then somebody else has to accept this. This is okay. And then we can continue. And then finally we can do it in production. So.
I know.
Yeah.
What does your security officer think about this?
Oh, that's interesting. on the one hand, it depends a little bit on who you ask.
Security officer.
And which security officer you ask. And sometimes a lot of people say, yeah, security says. We're discussing with them how the security aspects must be applied. But one of the big issues in here is that there must be traceability over the whole process. And
a separation of functionality and the users?
Yeah, separation of functionality and users, which means that somebody who creates a release is not allowed to certify it and things like that. And we have to adopt and adapt and the things like that. I was discussing that they have to get, in some cases, have to get used to this. I say, yeah, I have an automated process. Yeah, but we must trace it to somebody. I said, yeah, I have an automated process that in the middle of the night it runs. Yeah, but who did this? Yeah, nobody. It runs automatically. Yeah, but it must be traceable. So these discussions happen. And not only security. There's lots of other people who think in this way, and you have to discuss with them on how to handle these kinds of things. And I think
it triggers us to go back to the basic requirements for security. Not how we implemented it in the old-fashioned way, mm-hmm. but just look at the requirements, go back to it, and then implement them again within an automated system. And it is possible, but as Aino says, we have to adopt and adapt it.
And it requires a lot of discussion, especially because there's multiple parties involved. For example, this DINC, these guys were at the same thing. It's like, yeah, it must be traceable to a person. So to do a deployment, you must be logged in. And yeah, when you're at a web page and you do a manual deployment, you are logged in with your credentials. And then I said, okay, now I have a Jenkins user. Can I have a Jenkins user? Yes, you can. Can I have authorization on to execute the deployment in DINC? No, you can't. Okay, how am I going to do it then? Yeah, I use these kinds of discussions and how to organize this. That makes it interesting.
Do you think it will eventually go as far as to mandate? To make it mandatory for GPG signing on every Git commit, or for example, I mean, I don't want to force GPG on anybody, but right now that's a pretty good way of ensuring that at least the code is signed and trickles all the way through to production.
Yeah, we're already doing some of these things, not entirely. We are doing some kind of signing, but if needed. And that's what Brahma was also saying. Many people are thinking in the old-fashioned way, and they expect that when you're doing this, that it basically follows the old-fashioned way. And the moment that it doesn't, then it continues for some time, and at a certain point, there becomes friction and discussion and things like that. And then maybe, yeah, we need to do it, I don't know, but if possible, then one of the things was, for example, okay.
So I ended up having a lot of these conversations which go like, no humans is more secure than more humans, and no humans, more checks, rather than more humans, more checks. Right? Do you have a lot of similar types of conversations like that? Yeah.
Yeah, but the focus is still the ideas and the realizations is changing. People start to realize that automation, scripts, stuff like that, that it's in many cases much better performing than humans. Performing tests code testing and stuff like that, that's much better programmed than doing this as a human following a script and things like that. So regression testing, you cannot do without automated testing. And so this is becoming much more of the norm within the blasting teams. Many teams are already doing, what is it, 90% of the testing automatically.
We have this situation where Jenkins is running automated tests and gives a tick, but then because security says so, a person has to come and look at the tick and tick again. Yeah. Also, say tick, yep, tick again.
Yeah.
But for no reason. I mean, they don't actually check anything other than that Jenkins has said okay.
What happens is that there are some teams who are ahead of the other teams, and they are having lots of these discussions and things like that, and preparing what is security and other people to realize that the world is changing and that things are changing and things like that. So, yes, but definitely that's why I said in here we have the certify step and in here the accept step, which means that somebody must say this is okay. But in discussions with security, I already say, like, I expect that this is by teams at a certain point will be done automatically. The teams say, like, we trust our automatic tests. Mm. Yeah, but how can the? I said that's the way it's going. So, okay. So I don't show you the pipeline, but what I show is that we have a parameterized pipeline, which says that if you want to deploy it somewhere, you provide a URL. So a lot of parameters, and in this way, we can service our standard Java teams with a pipeline, with the same pipeline that everybody can use. And you provide the right parameters, and then it runs. That was the big party, beginning of this year. And the big starting of the adoption by many, but not by everybody. And the question is then, okay, you have a big party, and then you go home and you relax, or you continue. And we have to continue. Of course we have to continue. One of the things was that there were a few platform issues, like the lifecycle management was not optimally addressed, and we had some deployment performance issues. That was interesting, mainly on the mainframe, because what happens is the way it's organized, a deployment per component takes about 10 minutes. Okay, now for one, I can accept that, but if you have 10 components, then this will become a trouble. And at a certain point, our local optimizations, the teams were thinking like, hey, if we do it like this and like this and like this, and doesn't work anymore. So what we did an investigation. I said we had 80 teams, 200, 300 applications, and every application has a lot of components. And we asked two teams, how often do you want to deploy? And they said, basically, we are starting many, in essence, was that the developers are starting to I started on the journey to continuous delivery practices. If I commit now, I want to be verified as far as early as possible on our changes. And maybe if my change is okay, we have a deployable unit. Which means a few commits or pushes a day. For 500 application components, it means 2,500 deploys a day. Which means on average 5 deploys, which means if you can calculate it, it's about during the daytime, about 5 deployments a day. And I said it takes about 10 minutes for a component to deploy. So we have a problem. So that's an interesting thing. And this is actually very interesting to do something like that, because what we were doing were local optimizations, discussing with the deployment team, deployment to us, how can we optimize the deployment? But that doesn't solve this problem. If we can bring it from 10 minutes to 2 minutes, we still cannot help this. And this is what we are currently going, and probably in the future it will be growing and growing. So this was kind of a wake-up call, and this was kind of, this report was for management, also a report to discuss with management of the data center, what are we going to do? Okay. Basically, that's on there will be some issues with more iron is always a good option. There's other things. The other thing is, because we're on pipeline and not on infrastructure, we had some issue on the pipeline. You saw the parameters. Basically, the issue is we are the owner of the thing. We make the manual job creations. We have some complex and parameterized generic scripts. We do limited branching support, and we only support our standard enterprise Java applications. For this, it works, but if we're now going to scale to double the amount, that means that I will be sitting in the office the whole day working, fixing bugs in the scripts and things like that. Because we have limited and complex flexibility, the changes must go to us, they take time, and if you want to customize it as a team and do something that's not in there, then you have to take the whole script and make your own changes and go on your own. And it's actually not pipeline as code. Pipeline as code is my code, the pipeline is for the pipeline for my application, and if I make changes over there, I can track my changes. I can now even don't track my parameters. So we are constrained. And what's more important, on the one hand, it was very good to enable the teams to do their automation. It's actually not a pipeline. So they still don't know how their delivery process looks like.
It's all your fault.
Yeah, and it's our fault.
The easy name.
So basically what they did, instead of in the old times having the artifact, giving it to the people at Ops, they were giving it to us. And what also happened was that teams started to create their own pipelines. Because, ours didn't fit. And what happened was, they went on their own because we couldn't help them. And we were creating this diversity stuff and the what I was mentioning before. Teams were working on their own, doing their own stuff, and we didn't have a common ground. This is not scalable, this is not beheersbaar, and also not portable. And that's interesting why I put this here, because at this moment we are discussing maybe about container platforms. We are not running on containers, we are running on mainframe and IPaaS. But one of the scale, the performance things, maybe as a container platform might be one of the solutions for that. But that means that also your delivery process looks like, and if you're going to containers in some cases, the things completely must be reworked and things like that, and then you have to redo your work and things like that. So that's zonde van werk. Yeah, sometimes I forget what. So we have to continue. We have a good pipeline. We are on the top of a mountain. We're going to the next mountain, but there's many routes to that. And we can have different teams taking different routes. On the one thing, that's a good idea. On the other hand, we have teams that want to take another route. Let's make them, let's support them. But there's also many teams that want to be led. So, these kinds of stuff. 45 minutes, so I have some left. I have to start. Okay, I have to speed up a little bit. One of the things is, what are we going to do? We want to provide a stable, compliant, and future-proof continuous delivery platform. That's, for us as our team, one of the main goals. To make sure that teams can execute their delivery process in a controlled way, and that we use standard products, best practices, and standard patterns, and stuff like that. Because that's, in our opinion, the way to go, and to make sure that as a company, that you're doing the right things. So that means that this is our, yeah, line to go. That means the party was for pipeline version 2.1, and now we're going to version 2 and 3 and 4 and things like that. Which means that we want to support different technologies, and mainly, and this should be on top of it, the teams must have the ownership of their pipeline. One of the main important aspects, ownership by the team. And we support them. They know how their pipeline looks like, we know how to build pipelines. So let's combine our two, let's combine. This means that we are in control and compliant, and in control, that's very important in political situations, especially in our case. So that means that's a bit where we are standing now, where we're working on, which means that we can get the new era in. And basically, that's continuous delivery. Build automation, automate everything, and in essence, every code change is potential shippable. What we also want to do is deployment to P after this OK, and that it also must be automated. And now, we're using Jenkins 2 pipelines by the teams, and I've changed a little bit here. And I will explain why. Developers want this. And now we need the business to want this too. Because that's where the key issue is. We have our success with continuous integration. We want to continue with this success, but that's also a challenge that we must make sure that we can continue with it. And for that, we need culture change, standardization, organization stuff, and things like that. All the things that you read in the books about continuous delivery, that's what's going to apply here. That's what we experience now. Because that's our goal. We want to support teams to deliver whenever they want. Not 4 times a year, not 12 times a year, if you like. But if you are able to deliver it now, you can also you're also able to deliver it once a month. But the big challenges are not on the people, are not on the developers. So there's a little intermezzo. This is, in my opinion, the basic aspect of it. Continuous integration is about technology. Continuous delivery is about culture and organization. And I remember half a year ago a talk, by other guys, and they were struggling basically with this. They had a manager who was very willing in automation and supporting the automation, so they were able to implement continuous integration. But the next step was a problem because the manager was changed by somebody else, and this manager was not so interested in this, and basically they had a problem. And everybody started to, if you don't have your management a good vision on to continue, you will have problems, you will start to get frustrated and things like that. And this is, for me, one of the things. This is the basic challenge that you have to face. People saying, yeah, but we don't need to deploy. No, you don't need to deploy, but to be able to deploy, you need to address things. If you want to deploy, you must be in control. And that's, so, at the Belastingdienst, as an organization, we have some challenges. And this is a very generic part of the IT, because our IT looks in in 4 organizations. The data center, these are business applications, and in here there's all kinds of generic services and stuff like that. And our Josh team is one of this here. Which means that if they want to do continuous delivery, everybody must be organized. If there's a developer in here, I want to do more continuous delivery, I must make sure that everybody is aligned. And the more organization units you have, the more difficult it is. And that's one of the things as a big enterprise, as a government, and actually I've seen this in all my career, what very often happens is that we have organization sluggishness and that people start to, in Dutch you call it berusten, but yeah, that's the way it is, now it's never going to change. And that's the procedure and things like that. I'm now working for half a year with the Belastingdienst, and yes, this is there, but at the same time, the interesting thing is, if you start fighting it, people follow you. So people are willing to change, but they need somebody to kick and things like that. And they need people to continuously awake the organization and make sure that at a certain point things start changing. But that's the big challenge. Okay. So I'm gonna, I really have to skip now some things. A bit more on the pipeline version 2. This is again the main thing. So a half year ago I said it must be owned by the teams, which means they never had done, so we needed to awaken them. So how does it look like? We make sure that we provide a much more regularly updated Jenkins, so that we're able to follow the latest features, especially on the declarative syntax and on the multi-branch pipeline. If we do that, we are able to make provide a default pipeline, which the default teams can use without much problems, but that other teams that have a different wishes can easily change with some libraries and stuff like that. In addition, we have an internal open source development model. So if people have, especially on the libraries, have changes, it's not us that are going to do the changes, they make the changes and they provide a pull request, and then it's available. Which provides for us also a way that we do rigorously testing. So our delivery process must also be implemented in the way that we advocated to the other people. There are some challenges, because this means that teams get more responsibilities, and that we as a team must support the teams in applying their pipeline in the way that they need it. We have to let loose of some things. And I must say, sometimes I find it very difficult, because I think I know best. But I have to sit back and watch what people do and make sure that we do it together. That when other people do things and they make changes, that they share it with the others. And there is another very important part, I think, of continuous delivery and of continuous whatever, is make sure that you do knowledge exchange and things like that, that you build an internal community. Also, yes, enable teams in what they need to do, but the teams work for a company. And the company has some goals. And some of the goals are mainly make sure that we're stable, compliant, future-proof, and things like that. Because that's cheaper than if we do it in a different way. So big challenges on culture, organization, and basically on DevOps. Now we have, no, I'm not going to talk about that. So what's next? Because that's what we're basically now working on continuous delivery. And implement that and make sure that our teams can implement that. And there's a lot of challenges still to go. One of the things is that we are starting container platform. The provisioning, mainframe you don't provision because it's always there. But now with this, the IPaaS allows us to, for more flexible provisioning. So that's an interesting thing. Yes, we are going to production with pipelines. I'm not sure when. And there's a lot of people who don't want that. But I can assure you, that's what's going to happen. There are already some teams negotiating that. So, but again, culture, vision, and DevOps. And then, oh, sorry.
Question on the challenges, because if every team has to create its own pipeline, that takes time.
Yeah.
And now they probably don't spend that time, they can build their applications, yeah. And the business wants the applications as quick as possible. So is the business already aligned and saying, fine, that you start building your own CI pipeline, or and then spend less time on building the actual application? Or?
The idea is that there's a few things on that. One of the things is the position of our central YOS team, which is working for the teams to help them spend as less time needed on the pipelines. They have the teams know their pipeline or their specific process. We know how to build them, so when we sit together, we make default pipelines that they can instantly use. That's one of the things. The other thing is, a team is responsible for its product and to bring its product to production. A team is responsible, in my opinion, and for many opinion, for how the product runs in production. That means that bringing it to production is part of your responsibility. It must be part of your responsibility. And I agree with you, it shouldn't take you half of your time. But that's why we're automating everything. And that's why we have the old-fashioned way of deployment that we only do it a quarter, four times a year because it takes a week to bring it to deployment. But there is a little bit, there is a little bit of trade-off, but teams must have their own pipeline. That's the way to go. So, almost. Are we going to continuous deployment? I'm not sure. Oh, I don't even have. Probably there will be a few teams that will do it, but on the other hand, we'll see. Basically, what's the difference between continuous deployment and continuous delivery is basically that when you have a change, every change ships to production. Yeah, I'm not sure about if that's needed. Yeah, sometimes, in my opinion, yes. You provide. What is it? Variable software. So, to summarize, make sure that management, ambition, and business have a good vision on DevOps and containers. Cloud native, actually. And that's a bit of a problem with many governmental organizations because it seems that the top management is not always very technical, and on the one hand you don't need to be technical to be advocating DevOps, but the difference between successful organization and non-successful organizations is on this part. Now the rest you have been able to learn. Make sure that teams are central. So in my opinion, and now I had a very smart thing, the last takeaway is to empower the teams, but you can only do that by craftsmanship. And then I will end my presentation with old people like me who are 40 plus will remember this from some time. This is vakmanschap is meesterschap. Craftsmanship is what drives performance. So that's where I finish, and thank you. No, I don't. Okay, any questions? Yeah.
Two quick questions.
Yeah.
Well, at least the first one can be very quick. Belastingdienst, there's a lot of numbers. Is there anything else except unit testing, all kinds of testing? For example, something that actually proves that a process is correct, like using a language like TLA plus, or something to mathematically verify that the outcome is always correct. To your knowledge, is there any type of...
That's a very interesting question. That's a very good one. I've got to remember that. I don't know. Maybe you know?
No, but... Okay, that we don't know it doesn't mean to say that it isn't there. It's a big organization.
Yeah.
We don't know, for example, what the teams, the highly advanced teams are doing sometimes. We try to, but it's hard to keep up with all the teams.
And there are some special teams working on, for example, especially business rule stuff. And especially on all kinds of mathematical evaluations of the numbers, but
this is intelligence, yeah. For example.
If they do things like that, I'm gonna ask.
Okay, cool. And then a cultural question. Belastingdienst is, of course, Dutch. It's a Dutch governmental agency. How is the development culture within this company, this department, basically? Are there a lot of expats as well, or how is the demographic inside of the development community within the Belastingdienst?
Yeah, that's very interesting. Well, I started half a year ago, my age was 49 years old, and that was exactly the average age in the IT department. Which doesn't mean that we don't, it is a signal, but at the same time we are also doing classes, we're having young teams, we're having a lot of young people, so it is a bit, probably if we take the median, it will already be a lot lower, but still, it is it's a bit of a challenge, and we have to, what is it? They're working very hard to get younger people.
But also nationality-wise, yeah. Like, is it just a purely Dutch?
Mostly.
Hiring?
Yeah.
No, but we have also people from all over the world in who are hired to do specific jobs.
No, that's true. We have internal IT, but we also hire consultants,
yeah.
And from many companies. And what you say, indeed, are also foreigners, but it's expats. But I don't think it's a major.
No, not major, but mostly on bouwblokken. I don't know the English word for it. For code generation, for example, there are expats hired. And it's hard to say that we have one culture, because what you see is that we have a lot of older programmers, but on the other hand, there's fairly amount of new programmers coming up, and so there's not one culture. You see that that there are people who are working at home when they get at home, and they're searching for solutions for their problems there. But on the other hand, there are also people who want to leave the job behind when they're out of the office. So
it's very diverse.
Yeah.
And me, with my now 50 years old, I don't feel old. No, I feel young, actually, in some cases. And yeah, that's Now I can have a lot of anecdotes on all these kinds of stuff. Yes, on the one hand, there are people who are counting their time till 67, but there's a lot of other people who are very enthusiastic, embracing new technology and looking the best way to improve. So, okay, I will finish this. Other questions you can ask afterwards.